Hello and welcome to Political Theatre. India is the largest democracy in the world, and the twists and turns in the world of Indian politics attract everyone's attention. Several events take place simultaneously across the country, making it difficult for the people to keep a track of these events and understand their impact. In the next half an hour, we'll bring to you the top political events of the week and analyze and decode them for you. Both factions of the ruling AIADMK announced their merger this week. However, with more than a dozen MLAs loyal to Shashikala announcing their opposition to this merger, the political situation in Tamil Nadu remains fluid.
Amid moves and counter-moves, the political pendulum is swinging from one ADMK faction to the other. This week's political developments in the state, starting with the two warring factions of the ADMK, one led by Chief Minister E. Palaniswamy and other by O. Palaniselvam, announcing the merger. Under the merger agreement, O. Palaniselvam became the Deputy Chief Minister, while the two factions agreed to remove Jail Party Chief V.K. Sasikala and her nephew T.T.V. Dinakaran from the party. This move was met with a swift retaliation from Sasikala loyalist. Dinakaran announced a rebellion, taking 90 party MLAs to a resort in Puducherry. The rebels also met State Governor Vidyasagar Rao and told him that by merging the OPS faction that voted against Palaniswamy in a trust vote only 6 months ago, the Chief Minister had forfeited the confidence of the people.
These 19 MLA also voted that day to Honorable Chief Minister of the party to become a Chief Minister. But when they want to change in the government, why can't they call us? That is our question. And why they want to remove us? That is also another question. A CM should not say, you don't come. A CM must say, everybody come. So we want that.
After the merger, the ADMK now has 134 legislators and a 234-member assembly. If 19 rebel MLAs vote against the government, the ruling party is left with 115 MLAs, two short of simple majority of 117 seats. In a counter-move, Assembly Speaker P. Dhanapal sent all the rebel disqualification notices for going against the party line. Disqualification, in effect, will reduce the strength of the assembly and consequently the halfway mark, allowing the ADMK to retain its majority.
இனிமேலும் இது போன்ற செயலை அவர்கள் செய்வார்களானார் கட்சியையும் இந்த சின்னத்தையும் முடக்கவதற்கு காரணமாக இருந்த ஓபிஎஸ் அணி என்கின்ற சொல்லிக் கொள்கின்ற அந்த கூட்டம்.
Meanwhile, the opposition led by the DMK and its leader M.K. Stalin have demanded another vote of confidence in the state assembly. He claimed the disqualification notice could not affect the strength of the assembly as they were issued in connection with an episode that didn't happen in the assembly.
நம்பிக்கை கோரக்கூடிய வாக்கெடுப்பை நடத்துவதற்கு கவர்னர் உத்தரவிட வேண்டும், அதற்குரிய வகையில் சட்டமன்றத்தை கூட்ட வேண்டும்.
Dinakaran camp claimed that they will not let the speaker's disqualification move to go unchallenged and even take the matters to Supreme Court. The Dinakaran camp also say they have the support of more than 19 rebels. And more could join them in challenging the Chief Minister and his new deputy. The rebels, meanwhile, have been given a week to respond to the notice under the anti-defection law.
For more on this story, we are joined by our political analyst of the day, Mr. Ganapathy, Subramanium, senior journalist. Ganapathy, welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. Very interesting developments happening in Tamil Nadu. AIADMK is, facing a rebellion once again. Both factions merged. OPS became the deputy chief minister. But now it's the turn of the Dinakaran camp to rebel. How does the situation look like for the AIADMK now? Will they be able to overcome this political tide?
Despite all the challenges, the Dinakaran camp still has 19 MLAs.
And they claim the support of more than 19 also.
Of course, that is the most important part. The 19 are still very rallying, very close to him, and then they say more will join. First, when OPS and EPS joined together, everybody expected that the Dinakaran camp will be finished and everybody will be...
It'll be a happy ending.
And yeah, but that has not happened. He has managed, without any support, he has managed to hold on to 19 MLAs and he claims that more people will join him. And also, he is reshuffling the party administration like anything. He is sacking office bearers, appointing new office bearers. So people don't know who is the real authority. Mm-hmm. And when, tomorrow, when they have to face an election, who will be the real power? So that is why there is a lot of confusion. It is going to take quite a lot of time for all this to settle down. Either the EPS and OPS camp have to really come on strong and prove that they are the real ADMK, or Dinakaran is going to give them sleepless nights, make them go through a lot of trouble.
In this entire situation, is this the time for the DMK to go in for the kill? They have already asked for a confidence motion for the AIADMK government.
Of course, the DMK is doing that and the Congress is also pressing for assembly session. Mm-hmm. But the governor seems to be in no hurry as of now, because just now the budget session of Tamil Nadu Assembly has concluded, and so therefore they don't want to again rush in with another session. And also the situation as of now is not clear. Dinakaran's MLAs, while they claim that they are against the chief minister, but they are not against the government. They say this government is our government.
Okay.
There's a lot of confusion, and there is also one group trying to unite everybody together. They say everybody in AIADMK should unite. That is the only way to save the party and the government. Probably that is what is still keeping EPS alive.
Okay, so it seems like that things are not very easy for EPS and OPS in the ruling AIADMK, but they might have one more shot to go ahead and ensure that everything is smoothened in the ruling party. We'll take a short break here, and when we come back, we will take a look at two other important stories of the week, one regarding the political developments in Bihar, and the other about two big verdicts delivered by the Supreme Court this week. Stay tuned. Welcome back. The Supreme Court delivered two historic verdicts this week. While the apex court took a unanimous decision on the issue of right to privacy, terming it as a fundamental right under the Constitution, it also gave a majority decision on the issue of instant triple talaq, putting a stop to the practice till a law is enacted on the issue.
In a historic judgment this week, the Supreme Court struck down the 1,400-year-old practice of instant triple talaq among Sunni Muslims, calling it unconstitutional. A 5-judge constitution bench by a majority of 3-2 set aside the practice, terming it as a violation of right to equality and against the tenets of Islam. In the landmark judgment, the Supreme Court bench referred to abolition of instant triple talaq in Islamic countries and asked why independent India cannot get rid of it. The bench also said the practice needed to be stopped till Parliament enacted a substitute law. Political parties rushed to hail the judgment. Prime Minister Narendra Modi termed it as a powerful measure for women empowerment. The response of the main opposition party Congress was cautious, with party Vice President Rahul Gandhi also airing his views on Twitter. But the CPIM accused the BJP of taking credit for the judgment. West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee too steered clear of commenting on the verdict, but her cabinet colleague Siddiqullah Chaudhary termed it unconstitutional.
Muslim mahilaon ke paksh mein unke paksh ko vivekpurna aur nyayapurna tarike se sarvoch adalat ke samne rakhne ke liye sarkar aur pradhanmantri ji dono ko bhi party ki aur se dhanyavaad deta hu.
The Supreme Court has not accepted many of the arguments of the Attorney General representing the central government. So I don't think there is much for the central government to claim as its victory.
The verdict is an affirmation of the rights of Muslim women and gives relief to them against being subjected to discrimination by a practice that had been perverted over the years.
In a second landmark judgment 2 days later, the apex court unanimously declared that right to privacy was a fundamental right under the Constitution. The 9-judge constitution bench in its ruling said that right to privacy is an intrinsic part of right to life and personal liberty under Article 21 and the entire Part 3 of the Constitution. The bench was hearing a batch of petitions challenging the centre's move to make Aadhaar mandatory. However, the validity of sharing information of Aadhaar card will be decided by a separate 5-judge bench. Once again, political parties were quick to cash in on the judgment. While Rahul Gandhi called the verdict a major blow to the BJP's ideology of suppression through surveillance, the centre launched a scathing attack on the Congress, stating that Aadhaar during the then government had no protection of law.
It's not Aadhaar that is inconsistent with the right to privacy. It's the interpretation of this government of Article 21 which is an invasion of the right to privacy.
It's a big setback for the BJP government's efforts, which was trying to push that privacy is not a fundamental right and therefore it can be infringed upon.
UPA ne aadhaar laya tha bina kisi kanun ke. Aur puri charcha is baat se hui thi ki how could the government collect data or insist upon biometrics without any legislative sanction. To UPA sarkar ke kaam karne ka tarika tha. Phir humne ek comprehensive bill aaya known as the Aadhaar Act.
Both the judgments delivered by the apex court have put to rest several questions with political parties vying with each other to take credit for them.
For more on this story, our political analyst of the week, Mr. Ganapathy, is still with us. Very, very important verdicts, Ganapathy, two of them in a particular week, one with respect to right to privacy and the other which deals with the issue of instant triple talaq. The political parties seem to be in a hurry to claim credit. So, have these verdicts sort of, you know, simplified the way ahead from here onwards, or this will now get complicated due to the political one-up?
We have to look at them from two different viewpoints. The judgment on right to privacy is open to a lot of interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't open the door or shut the door, for example, on Aadhaar. At the same time, it also gives rise to a lot of new questions on what will be the rights of LGBTs, what will be the new view taken by the courts according on the basis of this judgment.
And what might be its impact on the RTI Act?
Of course, so many different aspects all will come for a review. Secondly, on the triple talaq, it has been already politicized by the main major political parties, including the Congress and the BJP. We saw the impact of that in the UP elections. And then it has seems to have had an impact which nobody perceived.
Mm-hmm.
So probably that way it is another step forward in the same direction. And the trend might be again unpredictable for what we know. Again, there will be a lot of interpretation on this as well. But then the right course for that will people will start discussing about uniform civil code, etc. So it's going to be a larger debate.
Obviously, it has opened the door to a larger debate on issues like uniform civil code. Let's take a look at another story out here, and this deals with the political developments in Bihar. While the ruling party, that is the JDU, is split over a turf war between the chief minister and senior leader Sharad Yadav, who claims to have the reins of the real JDU, their alliance with the BJP, which is just few weeks old, is now on a sticky wicket due to the allegations of a multi-crore Srijan scam.
The multi-crore Srijan scam has embarrassed the Nitish Kumar government in Bihar, with the opposition alleging direct involvement of the chief minister and his deputy Sushil Kumar Modi. The scam is about alleged transfer of government funds to an NGO Srijan Mahila Sahyog Samiti in Bhagalpur district of Bihar. The state assembly was adjourned sine die on Friday after furor over the scam, which was marked by sustained protests, walkouts and eviction of opposition members. The ruling alliance, however, has denied all allegations.
सूचना मिल रही है कि एक मौत नहीं इससे पहले भी कई और इस केस से जुड़े हुए लोगों की मौत हुई है हम शुरू दिन से ही ये चीजों को जताने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि ये व्यापम घोटाले से भी बड़ा घोटाला है मुख्यमंत्री जी और सुशील मोदी जी के संरक्षण में ये सारा खेल चल रहा था
2003 से ही मामला चल रहा तो उस समय राबड़ी देवी जी मुख्यमंत्री थी उजागर तो नीतीश कुमार जी ने किया विपक्ष का और लोगों का मांगवा कि सीबीआई जांच होना चाहिए देन एंड देयर नीतीश कुमार जी ने सीबीआई को चिट्ठी लिखकर सीपीआई जांच का आदेश दे दिया
Meanwhile, the ruling JDU, which unofficially split in two factions following Nitish Kumar's decision to ally with the BJP, is now busy in a turf war between the chief minister and senior leader Sharad Yadav. While the Nitish camp has suspended several supporters of Sharad Yadav from the party, the Sharad camp has moved the election commission, staking claim over the party symbol. The Nitish camp also sent a letter to Sharad Yadav, advising him against attending Lalu Yadav's rally in Patna on Sunday.
हमारे नेता शरद यादव जी और मैं खुद भी उस रैली में शामिल होऊंगा ये लड़ाई तानाशाही बनाम लोकशाही की है
अगर वो 27 तारीख को लालू जी की रैली में जाते हैं तो ये माना जाएगा कि भ्रष्टाचार से उनका भी मेल मिलाप हो गया है.
The public rally to be held by Lalu Yadav's RJD on Sunday in Patna is the first such event after parting ways with the JDU. With the TMC, SP and the Congress, along with rebel JDU leader Sharad Yadav likely to share the stage, the event is seen as flexing of muscles by the opposition parties.
Our political analyst for this week, Mr. Ganapathy, is still with us. Bihar seems to be pretty active as far as political developments are concerned. And this time around, things doesn't seem to be going very easy for the chief minister. Is he on a sticky wicket out here, in specifically with respect to Srijan scam and getting this pressure from inside the party from senior rebel like Sharad Yadav?
Lalu Prasad Yadav and opponents of Nitish Yadav want to put Nitish Kumar on a very sticky wicket. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't seem to be happening. One, why is Rahul Gandhi not attending the rally? Yeah, that's a very important question everybody is asking. Secondly, what kind of mass base does Sharad Yadav have? Nitish Kumar is far more popular than any of these people. That is the sentiment among the political circles in Bihar. Therefore, they may try very hard, but BJP is leaving no stone unturned to make sure that Nitish Kumar is comfortable. Today also we saw Prime Minister visiting Bihar and associating himself with the flood relief work in a big way directly. So therefore, I think it is going to be a tough fight for Nitish, but at the same time, he doesn't seem to be on a sticky wicket. He is very confident at the moment.
Okay, so as Ganapathy is pointing out, things might not look that easy for Nitish Kumar, but he seems to be prepared for all the challenges which are being thrown at him by the opposition, who were, just a few weeks ago, his partners in the power. We'll take a short break here, but when we come back, we will give you the details of other important political events happening across the country in this particular week and some interesting comments made by political leaders. Welcome back. From assembly bipolls for the four seats to political developments on rail accidents, let's take a look at what else made news in the political arena across the country this week.
BJP President Amit Shah and Union Minister Smriti Irani took oath as Rajya Sabha members. Rajya Sabha Chairman M. Venkaiah Naidu administered the oath to both Shah and Irani in his chamber in Parliament House. While the BJP chief, who was making his debut in Parliament, took oath in Hindi, Smriti Irani, who has been re-elected from Gujarat, took oath in Sanskrit. The Gujarat High Court has issued notice to the Election Commission and Congress leader Ahmed Patel on a petition filed by BJP candidate Balwant Singh Rajput challenging the Election Commission's decision to invalidate the votes of two Congress rebel MLAs in Rajya Sabha polls. Rajput, the BJP candidate who lost the Rajya Sabha poll from Gujarat, had moved the court against the EC's decision to invalidate the votes of two Congress rebel MLAs. He had quit the Congress ahead of August 8 polls. Assembly bipolls for four seats in three states were held this week. The seats are Delhi's Bawana, Andhra Pradesh's Nandyal and Goa's Walpoi and Panjim. Over 45% votes were polled in Bawana Assembly constituency. A high voter turnout of about 80% was recorded in the by-election to Nandyal Assembly constituency in Kurnool district of Andhra Pradesh. In Goa, Panjim constituency recorded 70% and Walpoi 79.80%. Prime Minister Modi presided over a meeting with all BJP ruled state 13 chief ministers and their 6 deputies at party headquarters in national capital this week. In the meeting, Prime Minister exhorted the chief ministers to implement all central welfare schemes in the state by the year 2022. Prime Minister also pushed for speedy implementation of pro-poor schemes and boosting transparency in government schemes. The United Democratic Front in Kerala has decided to continue the ongoing agitation by 5 of its legislators on the assembly premises, demanding Health Minister K.K. Shailja's resignation. The meeting of the UDF leaders authorized Leader of the Opposition Ramesh Jenithala to take appropriate decisions that would keep the pressure on Pinaray Vijayan government on the issue.
Several political situations led to interesting comments by political leaders in a bid to counter each other's claims. We have shortlisted the best ones for you in Face Off.
Rail hadse अब भारतीय रेल का पर्यायवाची बन गए हैं। उन्हें उनका इस्तीफा मंजूर हो या उन्हें पदमुक्त किया जाए और प्रधानमंत्री ये बताएं कि रेल सुरक्षा को लेकर वो क्या कदम उठाएंगे।
Well, accountability is a good system in government. The Prime Minister will take a decision on whatever request the Railway Minister has made.
अति पिछड़ी जातियों के लिए और क्रिमिलियर की सीमा को बढ़ाने के लिए किए गए इस फैसले का स्वागत करते हैं, अभिनंदन करते हैं।
यानी पीनट है, ये आईवास है, वो एक तरह से रिजर्वेशन को एक हाथ से देना दूसरे हाथ से छीनना है।
मोहरम आछे তাই দশমীর দিন কিন্তু সন্ধে ছটা পর্যন্ত বিসর্জন দেওয়া যাবে। একাদশীর দিনটা শুধু দেওয়া বিসর্জন হবে না, কারণ ওই দিন মহরম আছে বলে।
সিফ তুষ্টিকরণ কা রাজনীতি কা কারণ হিন্দু মুসলমান মে পশ্চিম বঙ্গাল কো ডিভাইড করনা চাহতে হ্যায় আর উসমে হিন্দু কা জিতনা পূজা পাঠ হ্যায় সারে বন্ধ করনে কা কোশিশ মমতা ব্যানার্জি নে কর রহা হ্যায়।
ইন লোগো নে জো ভি কুছ কিয়া ইনকো পুরি সাজা মিলেগি, উসমে কুছ লোগো নে জো গোলিয়া চালাই হ্যায় ভো ভি পকড়ে গয়ে হ্যায়, উনকে খিলাফ কারওয়াই কি জায়েগি।
দিস ইজ অ্যান ইনএফিশিয়েন্ট ইনকম্পিটেন্ট ইনএফেক্টিভ স্টেট গভর্নমেন্ট খট্টর সরকার, ইট শুড হ্যাভ বিন রিমুভড আ ওয়াইল এগো, ইট মাস্ট বি রিমুভড ইমিডিয়েটলি আন্ডার প্রেসিডেন্টস রুল।
মোদি গভর্নমেন্ট ক্যান নট ফাইন্ড এনি কম্পিটেন্ট পুলিশ অফিসার ইন ইন্ডিয়া to head the National Investigation Agency, and the principal accused Sadhvi Pragya has already been given a clean chit by NIA in the case.
They had coined these terms, saffron terrorism and Hindu terrorism, and today we can see as to how the Congress party tried to do all this because of appeasement politics.
Apart from television studios, protest marches and public rallies, politicians were also busy taking a dig at each other and making their point on social media. Let's take a look at what all transpired in the virtual world of Indian politics.
Railways Minister Suresh Prabhu took to Twitter to express his anguish over two rail accidents in 5 days in which over 20 people lost their lives. In a series of tweets, Prabhu said that he takes moral responsibility for the derailments and met the Prime Minister on the issue. He also said that he has inherited a two-decade-old neglected Indian Railways and has devoted his blood and sweat for its betterment. CPIM General Secretary Sitaram Yechuri slammed the Trinamool government over banning Durga immersions during Muharram next month. Yechuri said that Mamata Banerjee is competing with the Modi government in spreading communalism. He also said that the previous left government was successfully managing immersions of both the faiths, and it is the job of the state government to ensure that religious events pass off peacefully. Meanwhile, reacting to tweets on immersion issue, Trinamool leader Derek O'Brien lashed out, saying that it is impractical to comment on administration issues of West Bengal from New Delhi. Several political leaders lashed out at the Haryana government on Twitter for failing to control violence following verdict on Dera Sacha Sauda chief Gurmeet Singh. Omar Abdullah tweeted that the ruling Haryana government should be sacked for failing to maintain the law and order situation. Congress leader Randeep Surjewala also tweeted that the state government failed in maintaining law and order and sought the resignation of Chief Minister Manohar Lal Khattar. Chief Minister Khattar took to Twitter to appeal for restraint and said strict action will be taken against the agitating perpetrators. Prime Minister Narendra Modi also deeply condemned the violence and mounting death toll.
So this was the summary of twists and turns in the world of Indian politics this week. We will be back again next week with some more interesting information and analysis. Till then, we will leave you with these visuals. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.